Amminadab. Amminadab fathered Nashon. Nashon fathered Salmon, or Salmon. Salmon fathered Boaz by Rahab. Boaz fathered Obed by Ruth. Obed fathered Jesse. And Jesse fathered King David. Then David fathered Solomon by Uriah's wife. Solomon fathered Rehoboam. Rehoboam fathered Abijah. Abijah fathered Asa. Asa fathered Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat fathered Joram. Joram fathered Uzziah. Uzziah fathered Jotham. Jotham fathered Ahaz. Ahaz fathered Hezekiah. Hezekiah fathered Manasseh. Manasseh fathered Amon. Amon fathered Josiah, and Josiah fathered Jeconiah and his brothers at the time of the exile to Babylon. Then after the exile to Babylon, Jeconiah fathered Shealtiel. Shealtiel fathered Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel fathered Abiad. Abiad fathered Eliakim. Eliakim fathered Azor. Azor fathered Zadok. Zadok fathered Achim. Achim fathered Eliad. Eliad fathered Eleazar. Eleazar fathered Mathan. And Mathan fathered Jacob. And Jacob fathered Joseph, the husband of Mary, who gave birth to Jesus, who was called the Messiah. So all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations. And from David until the exile to Babylon, 14 generations. And from the exile to Babylon until the Messiah, 14 generations. Thus is the reading of God's word. Will you pray with me, please? Jesus, this morning we come in your name. We come, Lord, to seek your face. Lord, open up our eyes this morning to see you. Open up our ears to hear your word, your truth, your gospel. Jesus, open up our hearts this morning. Cause our hearts, Lord, to turn to you in confession, in repentance, and in faith. And trust.
President Biden will give a speech Tuesday. The White House says he'll discuss the national.
Jesus, may your word and your gospel for the winter. Go forth
the CDC
this morning.
Introduced a new step Friday.
It's in your
kids
name we pray, Jesus. Amen.
Now stay in school, provided they're frequently tested instead of having to quarantine at home.
Abraham Lincoln.
Contributor Dr. John Brownstein says
we have the tools that we
John
need
F.
Right
Kennedy.
Now, between masking, social distancing, and vaccines. And
Martin Luther King Jr.
To keep our kids in schools right now. In addition to this test and stay program.
Harriet Tubman.
ABC's Christine Sloan says some other policies are changing.
Muhammad Ali.
Delaying three games this weekend, the NFL is enacting new COVID
Tom Brady.
Protocols that will include a more targeted testing and the ability
Michael
for
Jordan.
Players to opt out for the rest of the season. The NHL is also
Donald Trump.
Postponing several games, and Harvard is announcing plans to return
Joe Biden.
To online learning for the first 3 weeks in January, joining a
What's in a name?
Number of schools that have made similar decisions.
As I read those names just now, what kind of things came to your mind? What emotions did you feel? What events did you go back to? What accomplishments do you remember? You see, names are powerful. Names have meaning, and names have history. Over the last several years, I don't remember when she started, but my wife has been exploring the genealogies of both her mom and her dad's lineage, as well as my own. This completely enthralled her. It was fascinating, and she was always excited to share when she made an amazing new discovery and found an amazing new person and something that they did. But what's most exciting when you're looking at genealogies, especially your own, is when you come upon somebody who's famous, who has lots of history. One such person, and I believe it's on your mom's side, is Wyatt Earp. So what do you think of when you hear the name Wyatt Earp? You think lawman, hero, gunslinger, Old West. Names conjure up all sorts of thoughts in emotions, places, and events. To think about a guy like Wyatt Earp, or even one of the names that I mentioned above, we think of greatness at times. We think of these great accomplishments. But when we think of those people, and we actually are able to connect those people to our own lineage and our own genealogy, it takes that discovery on, puts it on a whole other level. Names in our family's past can define us, and they can bring us identity. And this was indeed the case, if not more so, for the Jewish people. What's in a name? N.T. Wright, in his book, The New Testament and Its World, states the following. Matthew's opening, so apparently boring to a modern Western reader, would be electrifying for a first century Jew. Why? Well, just a little background. So, at the time of Jesus' coming, Israel was really in a state of hopelessness. See, it had been 400 years since the last book of the Old Testament, Malachi, was written. And it felt to them that God had become silent. You see, they had been promised a Messiah. They had been promised a Savior, a King. And years went by, and decades went by, and centuries went by, and still no Messiah. And thus, it brings us to Matthew. Matthew begins his gospel with the words, the historical record of Jesus, Messiah, or Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. You know, what is one little interesting thing about this is usually when you start a genealogy, you start with the first person. You don't start with the most recent person. So you start with the first person, you go back. But here Matthew is starting with the genealogy of Jesus Christ. Sorry, I lost my face. Most Israelites were able to trace their lineage for generations and generations. Knowing their family's genealogy brought them a sense of identity and purpose and meaning. And it was considered a significant blessing if they could trace their genealogy back to someone famous, say like a Moses or a Gideon. This would bring so much more significance and meaning to their family. But is it as important as their own genealogy was to them? What was even more significant was tracking the genealogy and the lineage of the Messiah. So why would this genealogy be so electric to Jewish ears? Well, embedded within this genealogy are three unique covenants that God has made. Now, two of these covenants were made to individuals, and one of them was made to the nation of Israel. So, let's take a look at this. So, we're going to start with the first name in this list, Abraham. So, who was Abraham, and why was he so important? I'm going to ask the Engel family to come up and help me with this for a second. Now, Abraham, if you remember, was called by God. There was nothing significant necessarily about Abraham that made him special above anybody else, but God chose Abraham. And he chose to do a number of different things through Abraham. We're going to look at three passages this morning. Briefly, the first one will be Genesis 12, 1 through 3. The second will be Genesis 15, 1 through 6. And the third will be Genesis 17, 1 through 8. And as they read these passages, I want you to pay special and close attention to all of the promises that God makes to Abraham. So go ahead. Thank you.
Now the Lord said to Abraham, go forth from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land which I will show you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, and so you shall be a blessing, and I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed.
After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Fear not, Abram, I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. This man shall not be your heir. Your very own son shall be your heir. And he brought him outside and said, look toward the heaven and number the stars, if you are able to number them. And then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. And he believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness.
When Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, that I may make my covenant between me and you, and may multiply you greatly. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be the father of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the father of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make you into nations, and kings shall come from you. And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you throughout their generations for an everlasting covenant, to be God to you and to your offspring after you. And I will give to you and to your offspring after you the land of your sojournings, all the land of Canaan, for an everlasting possession, and I will be their God.
Thank you. Yep, you're done. Thank you. So I don't know if you caught all, there's a lot. There's a lot in there. I'm just going to list, go through some of them here. So God said to Abraham, I will make you into a great nation. He said, I will bless you and I will make your name great. You will be a blessing and all the peoples of earth will be blessed through you. An heir will come from your own body and your offspring will be as numerous as the stars in the sky. You will be given a land to possess. You will be extremely fruitful. Nations and kings will come from you. And this will be an everlasting covenant for God to be his God and Abraham's offspring to be his people. So what's in a name like Abraham that would be so electric to Matthew's Jewish hearers? Well, for one, Abraham was the patriarch of patriarch. He was the father of fathers. He was the father of the Jewish people. He, in essence, was their history. But two, as I just read this list, covenant and promise. Covenant and promise. And what Matthew is letting his readers know is that these covenants that God made with Abraham, those promises that God made to Abraham, are now being fulfilled in Jesus. There are three specific ones, though, I want us to just kind of keep in the back of our minds. So for God said to Abraham, he would make him a great nation. He said he would be a blessing to all nations. And he said that this covenant that he's making would be an everlasting covenant. And when God makes a covenant, he always, always fulfills the promises that he lays out. Always. So again, Matthew creates this amazing road from Abraham all the way to Jesus. And what an amazing road it is. So there's 14 generations from Abraham to David. So let's move on to David. Same question. Why was David, who was David, and why was he so important? Well, Saul was Israel's first appointed king. And Saul, like a lot of the kings of Israel, started out upright and righteous. But eventually he disobeyed God. God became angry with him, and he ripped the kingdom from his hands. And so then God chose a new king. And he had Samuel the priest anoint David as that king. And when he went out to Jesse, David's father, to find the king, there was this long line of boys. It's not that one. It's not that one. It's not that one. It's not that one. It's the youngest, David. So once again, not the guy you would necessarily expect to be anointed as the king. So David's anointed king, and then eventually God makes a covenant with David. I'm going to turn to Samuel chapter 2, excuse me, 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 11 through 16. The Lord declares to you, the Lord himself will make a house for you. When your time comes and you rest with your fathers, I will raise up after you your descendant, who will come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be a father to him, and he will be my son. He will be a son to me. When he does wrong, I will discipline him with a human rod and with blows from others. But my faithful love will never leave him. As I removed it from Saul, I removed him from your way. Your house and kingdom will endure before me forever, and your throne will be established forever. So what does God promise David here? He says that there will be a descendant's kingdom that will be established, meaning Solomon. He will build a house for my name. Then he says his kingdom and his throne will be established forever. And your house and your kingdom will endure before me forever. What's in a name like David that was so electric to Matthew's hearers? Well, David was Israel's King of Kings. He was that gold standard. And Israel believed that the Messiah would also be the king from David's line spoken about in this covenant. And once again, we have covenant and we have promise. We have covenant and promise. And again, Matthew points his readers to say that Jesus is that fulfillment. So Matthew concludes this genealogy, he says, from the time after the exile to Jesus. And within the exile, there also comes a covenant and a promise. So what did God promise Israelites that he would do for them when he brought them back from exile? Well, Jeremiah chapters 29 through 31, don't worry, I'm not going to read all of those. But Jeremiah's chapter 29 through 31, Jeremiah details all of which the Lord is promising to do with his people when he brings them back from captivity in Babylon. What I want to focus on is Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34. Reading Jeremiah 31 through 34. Look, the days are coming, This is the Lord's declaration. When I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, this one will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant they broke even though I married them. The Lord's declaration. Instead, this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days. The Lord's declaration. I will put my teaching within them and write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will one teach his neighbor or his brother, saying, "Know the Lord," for they will all know me, from the least to the greatest of them. This is the Lord's declaration. For I will forgive their wrongdoing and never again remember their sin. So what promises did God make to his people, bringing them out of exile? He said he would make a new covenant. He said his teaching would be written upon their hearts. He said that all the people, from the least to the greatest, would know the Lord. He said all wrongdoing would be forgiven and sins would be remembered no more. And he said, I will be their God, and they will be my people. And so again, Israel was waiting for a Messiah. They were waiting for a new covenant. And again, 400 years had passed since God had spoken through Malachi. And they were waiting in hopelessness because it had gotten so long and so long and so long. So what's in a name? What's in the name of Jesus? We have here in the genealogy of Jesus three covenants that God has made to his people. We have a line going back from Jesus all the way to David and to Abraham. We see here the Abrahamic, the Davidic, and the promise of new covenant, all pointing directly to Jesus. I do want to pause for just a moment and make a few observations about this genealogy. You see, God is faithful at keeping his promises through the faithfulness of his people and through the unfaithfulness of his people. Through those that were of Israel and those who were not of Israel. We start out with Abraham, and yes, God made that covenant with Abraham, but do you remember what Abraham did? He got impatient. And so he slept with his wife's slave in order to speed up God's timing, because that always goes well when we try to speed up God's timing. Well, and then we have Jacob. Well, what did Jacob do? He stole his brother's birthright. Tamar was Judah's daughter-in-law, and that's a whole other story in and of itself. Thought she was a prostitute. Rahab was a prostitute. And then David, well, David doesn't pull any punches here, starting out with his line. He said, then David fathered Solomon by Uriah's wife. We all know that story. David wanted Uriah's wife, so he had Uriah killed. Well, and then there's Solomon. Solomon was the wisest guy who ever lived. So he got 700 wives and 300 concubines. He disobeyed God. And he brought those wives in, those foreign wives and concubines in, and started worshiping other gods. He brought other gods into Israel. And why in the first place do you think that Israel was put into exile to Babylon? Well, because of unfaithfulness. Because you can, I mean, you can go through and you can look at all these different kings that we see here. And there are some that would say they did right in the eyes of God, but there were more that says they did evil in the eyes of God, in the eyes of the Lord. Yet, despite his people's unfaithfulness at times, God remained steadfast and faithful in keeping his covenants and promises. Despite their sin, despite the countless times they decided to take matters into their own hands, God still was faithful. His ways, his promises, his plans will not be thwarted. And so Matthew weaves this beautiful, amazing tapestry for his readers. This mind-blowing picture of Jesus being the long-awaited Messiah, coming from the line of David, coming from the line of Abraham. So again, how often have you opened the book of Matthew and we skip over this genealogy? We think there are people, and I kind of probably botched some of them. We see names of people and we have no idea who they are and we can't even pronounce their names. And so we skip and we go on to the birth of Jesus. And that's obviously what we are coming to celebrate this next week. So why should this matter to us today? Why should we care about Matthew chapter 1, verses 1 through 17? What can this genealogy, what hope can this bring us today? I want you to turn to the end of Matthew. I'm going to read the last closing words that Matthew records of Jesus. And most of us will know, we hear this as the Great Commission. We see this in different churches' visions and mission statements. It's what we are told to do as Christians, like the apostles, that we are called to do, to go, to preach, to teach. And I don't disagree with that. But these words of Jesus hold so much more weight and power, knowing what we just discovered in this genealogy. Read Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 through 20. The disciples traveled to Galilee, to the mountains where Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshiped. But some doubted. Then Jesus came near and said to them, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey or observe everything I have commanded you. And remember, I will be with you always to the end of the age." So what did God promise the Israelites coming out of the exile? He said that he would make a new covenant, where the teaching would be on the hearts, his law would be in the hearts of men, that sins would be forgiven, that he would be their God, and they would be his people. What were the promises made to Abraham? That all nations would be blessed that his descendants would be as numerous as the stars in the sky, and that the covenant would be an everlasting covenant. And what was the promise made to David? That his kingdom would be everlasting, and that his throne would be established forever. Going back to Matthew chapter 28, what authority did Jesus say he has, and where? All authority in heaven and on earth. And who would have all authority? The king. And where were the apostles told to go? To all nations. And who did God tell Abraham would be blessed? All nations. And how long did Jesus say he would be with us? Always. To the very end of the age. So what's in a name? What's in the name of Jesus? Everything. Covenant. Promise, fulfillment. But as we just read, these promises to Abraham, to David, to the Israelites, they have not stopped. God is still, through Jesus, building a people for himself. God, through Jesus, is still dwelling amongst his people. And Jesus, the King, is still reigning and ruling with all power and justice forever. What is our hope? Our hope is God, through Jesus, has never and will never stop in keeping the promises that he has made to his people. Go and proclaim him today. Amen.